Although lacrosse made appearances on the Franklin and Marshall campus as early as the mid-1920s, it was in the spring of 1947 that the sport made its first sustained appearance, organized by undergraduate Sig Hyman and geology graduate student John Mills. Lacrosse wasn't organized as a club activity. The first coach was Tom Smith, and through the generosity of legendary Swarthmore coach A.V. Blake, the squad was given a set of used equipment. The early teams slowly developed the caliber of their schedules and received outstanding play from Jules Lichter and Walt Zeger. By 1950, the college had accorded the lacrosse program provisional varsity status. Although the program was dropped after the 1951 season, a solid beginning had been achieved through the efforts of early teammates Bill Lampe and A.B. Adler. In 1956, the lacrosse program was revitalized under the direction of Jim Stewart and John White. Competing in a league consisting of the University of Pennsylvania, Penn State, Delaware, Drexel, Swarthmore, Lehigh, and Dickinson, wins were hard to come by. During this period, Jim Stewart on attack was consistently named to the all-league team, and the team was ably coached by Mel Kupilnik, who acted as a player coach. In 1959, the sport reached a milestone as it was designated as a sanctioned varsity sport. Pastor Ted Trost coached the team that was led by Sandy Babos, who had experience playing high school lacrosse in New England. In addition to Babos, the team was fortunate to have Sean Deans Crystal as their goaltender and Al Hillman as captain. The official lacrosse guide of 1959 stated, quote, "The highlight of the F&M season was the 1-point loss to Dickinson and Deans Crystal in goal," close quote. In 1960, the team was captained by Deans Crystal and played its first official season as a member of the United States Intercollegiate Lacrosse Association. By the early 1960s, the sport had solidified its popularity at the college. In 1964, new coach Tom Gilbert, a member of the Baltimore Colts football team, arrived on the scene, and in 1965, Franklin and Marshall had its first winning season, winning 7 and losing 5. From a team that was led by Captain Bob Aber, an outstanding play from Mel Heath, Kaplan, and John Frary, who were all-league selections. In 1967, a new era arrived at the college. For the first time, a full-time coach had been hired, and that individual was Ross Sachs. During his first season, the team was led by Al Stone and Marshall Steele, both all-league selections despite a team with a 1-9 record. In 1968, the team demonstrated progress as attackman Jeff Becker led his team to a 6-5 victory over Drexel and set a team record for most goals in a game with 8. In 1969, the team struggled in vain to reach 500. This was the final year that freshmen would not be allowed to play varsity sports. With veterans Dick Block and Mike Hogan as captains, the 1970 season was full of promise. This was the year of the breakthrough as the years of losing came to an end. The Sachs method of coaching found its voice as a combination of veterans and a core of talented sophomores combined to serve notice that Franklin and Marshall would be a force to contend with for league opponents. Senior Stan Brand was inserted as a starter at crease attack and found a niche which would serve as a template for future attackmen. During the season, the team found themselves trailing 4-0 at the end of the first quarter while visiting Penn State. Coach Sachs calmly called a timeout and reorganized his team. As the defense dug in, the Diplomats scored 6 unanswered goals for an exciting 6-4 victory. For the first time, F&M became a league contender. Senior Rusty O'Brien was selected as F&M's first All-American lacrosse player. And Kevin Gaddow, Chris Franklin, and Charles Greenslit were named All-League. In goal, sophomore Steve Revell had a solid year. The boys of spring became the crew of wooden sticks and iron men. The performance of 1970 would be hard to beat. Coach Sachs had a crew of veteran juniors and a handful of promising freshmen who had to be integrated into his system. Following a few early season losses, Coach Sachs, always innovative, reshuffled his team. Steve Revell, in a great gesture of team play, agreed to move from goal to midfield to add his considerable athletic talent to reinforce the core of middies. He was an outstanding goalie, and his career at midfield was equally distinguished. At midseason, defending league champion University of Delaware was scheduled for a visit to Baker campus. Much to their shock, they ran into a revitalized F&M team. The scoring was opened by new midfielder Steve Revell, while rookie goalie John Martino had 10 first quarter saves, leading F&M to a 1-0 lead at the end of the first period. Junior Chris Franklin scored 4 goals, and senior John Morgan contributed 1, along with junior Kevin Gaddow. When the dust finally settled, Franklin and Marshall had beaten the University of Delaware for the first time, 7-6. John Martino recorded 27 saves, and F&M had launched what would become a 42-game league-winning streak. The 1972 season got off to a brisk start with impressive wins over Bucknell, Penn State, Drexel, Delaware, and Lafayette. During the season, Tim Muller consistently shut down the leading scorers of each opposing team. The attack, consisting of David Cloud, Paul Friedman, and Chris Franklin, were methodical in their ball control and their ability to score goals. The defense of Mike Pulwer, Robert Baker, and Tim Muller was nearly impregnable. In the final league contest against an inspired Gettysburg team, senior Joe Ward emerged from a 4-year backup role and replaced an injured Chris Franklin with a 4-goal and 4-assist performance in a 12-4 victory to clinch the league crown. Tim Muller was selected as a third-team All-American at defense and was named the league's most valuable player. Franklin and Marshall was invited to the first USILA tournament hosted at Williamson Field. Despite a 10-9 loss to Washington College, the matchup was considered to be one of the best lacrosse games of the 1972 season. Chris Franklin, the team MVP, was selected along with Tim Muller to be F&M's first North-South game representatives. 1973 was supposed to be a rebuilding year, with the loss of many fine seniors in the class of 72. To the surprise of everyone, it turned out to be a reloading year. The 1973 squad went 12-0 against league opponents, extending the combined winning streak to 26. They had successive victories over Swarthmore, Harvard, Bucknell, Penn State, Lebanon Valley, Dickinson, Drexel, Lehigh, Delaware, Lafayette, Gettysburg, and Western Maryland. The team was invited to play in the second USILA tournament and scored a first-round 10-2 victory over Lebanon Valley. The team was anchored on defense by Bobby Baker, Nick DeRobertis, and Marshall Long at midfield. And a new attack team of Paul Friedman and Sam Goodell was emerging as a tenacious force. In goal for junior John Martino, it was a year characterized by a lot of saves, few allowed goals, and a .764 save percentage. Martino set 2 F&M records, one for most saves in a single game, 37 against Hobart, and the other for making 221 saves in a season, a record which would not be broken until 1988. For his efforts, the goalie was selected as the team's MVP and received honorable mention All-American honors. Going for the three-peat in 1974, for Coach Ross Sachs' squad was not easy. Every team in the league was gunning for the two-time champions and looking to break the undefeated string. With solid victories over league contenders Delaware and Lehigh, F&M was set for a dramatic showdown with Drexel University's high-powered offense, featuring two All-American attack players. The first half did not go well for the visiting Diplomats. Trailing 8-2 just before halftime, Paul Friedman scored on an outside cannon blast, making the halftime score 8-3. In a dramatic second half turnaround, the defense led by Mike Lamond, Rick Davis, and Richard Gray suddenly stiffened. The attack of Sam Goodall, Paul Friedman, and Bruce Cobb came to life. In the second half, F&M outscored Drexel 6-1. In the last 2 minutes of regulation, the Drexel attack peppered the F&M goal with shot after shot, several coming at point-blank range. Each time, senior goaltender John Martino turned them away with textbook saves. The game went into double overtime, and Paul Friedman put in the go-ahead goal in the first overtime period. With 40 seconds remaining in the second overtime, Drexel took one last point-blank shot. The save was made, and a long outlet pass to Jimmy Cotter resulted in an assist to Sam Goodall for the final insurance goal, and a stunning come-from-behind 11-9 victory. This game represented the largest deficit that any F&M team had ever overcome. On that day, Sam Goodall and Paul Friedman accounted for all of the F&M goals. John Martino had 19 saves in the cage. Just as the 1974 season was ending, the Division I schools, Drexel, Penn State, Lehigh, Bucknell, and Delaware, announced that they would be dropping out of the Middle Atlantic Conference beginning in 1975. This set up a final showdown between undefeated Bucknell and the undefeated Diplomats, which took place on May 1st at Williamson Field. It was a classic defensive battle, with Paul Friedman scoring 3 goals, with added tallies by Steve Carroll, Rick Harmon, and Joe Petrick. In the 6-3 victory, John Martino had 17 saves, and the third consecutive MAC title was secured. In a fitting tribute, legendary coach Sid Jamison of Bucknell was interviewed by the correspondent for the F&M College Reporter. He said, quote, "The biggest difference was in the cage. Martino is an excellent goalie," close quote. He added that he was happy that Marshall Long would soon be graduating. The league-winning streak had now stretched to 36, spanning 4 years. Marshall Long was named as the team's most valuable player and was selected as an honorable mention All-American at midfield. He was also selected to participate in the North-South game. John Martino was named as a third-team All-American goalie and was a unanimous selection as the league's most valuable player. Opening day of the 1975 season witnessed the Diplomats playing the defending national champion Cornell University at Williamson Field. Despite a significantly altered league structure, F&M added 6 wins to the league-winning streak, which ended with a final season loss to Gettysburg. Richard Gray was selected as an honorable mention All-American on defense. Andy Snyder was the team's MVP in goal. And Nick DeRobertis was selected to participate in the North-South game. John Hatch, Sam Goodall, and Nick DeRobertis were first-team All-League selections. Paul Friedman set a new F&M career scoring record with 99 goals and 67 assists for a total of 166 points. Incredibly, seniors DeRobertis, Friedman, Ray, and Snyder were members of four consecutive championship teams. The 1976 Diplomats posted a 7-7 record and came within one game of the league title. They received outstanding performances from John Conte on defense and Bill Levy on attack, who were both first-team All-League selections. The 1977 team posted a 7-0 league record and had highlight victories over the University of Baltimore and Drexel University before winning competitive games against Gettysburg, Western Maryland, and Wilkes to secure the MAC league title on the last day of the season. John Conte was named honorable mention All-American, as Conte, John Hatch, Tom Howley, Bill Levy, and Bruce Cobb were all first-team All-League selections. Buck O'Leary tied the record for most goals in a game with 8. The trio of Cobb, Levy, and O'Leary set a record of 168 points as a combined attack unit. For the Diplomats, the 1978 campaign was highly competitive. They defeated a University of Delaware team ranked 8th in the nation, 11-10 in overtime. Gordy France closed out an outstanding career in goal. Conte was named third team All-American at defense and represented the Diplomats at the North-South Classic. 1979 was a transition year, with outstanding performances from Dave Tettenbaum at midfield and John Lopezona at attack. They defeated Penn State 8-7 and Gettysburg 7-6. The 1980 squad captured the MAC crown by defeating Fairleigh Dickinson 7-6 for the league championship on the final day of the season. They defeated Western Maryland and Gettysburg at midseason and had outstanding performances from Larry Lockman in goal, Steve Growney and Mike Scabelli on defense, Joe Schaller and Andy Grossman at midfield, and Buzzy Vail at attack. All were All-League selections. The team finished 11th in the final NCAA Division III poll. Following outstanding performances by Richard Dolan and Joe Schaller, who scored 45 and 22 goals respectively, the 1981 team paved the way for what Ross Sachs frequently referred to as one of his very best teams, the 1982 squad. In 1982, the team got off to a quick start with exciting wins over William & Mary, 10-8, Bucknell, 10-9 in overtime, Gettysburg 12-7, Western Maryland 13-7, and Lehigh 15-5. They captured the Eastern Division league title, but lost to Swarthmore 16-12 in the MAC finals. The level of competition was high as the team suffered a close loss to a rapidly developing Princeton team 15-12. Midfielder Joe Schaller was named to the All-American third team and was selected to represent the Diplomats at the North-South game. Steve Growney was named All-American honorable mention on defense, and Tom Swift was selected as a third team All-American in goal. He had as good a season as any goalie had ever had at Franklin and Marshall. 5 Diplomats were named to the All-MAC team: Howley, Peter Schaefer, Joe Schaller, Tom Swift, and Steve Growney. In 1983, 1984, and again in 1985, the Diplomats secured the Eastern Division title of the Middle Atlantic Conference, only to lose in the final games by 1 goal each year. ...1986 was a historic year for Franklin and Marshall lacrosse. In March, the team conducted a 4-game tour of England. The regular season started off with victories over Swarthmore, Trinity, Lafayette, Mount St. Mary's, and Gettysburg. They won the MAC title for the first time since 1980, with a convincing win over FDU Madison, 20-5. Peter Bidstrup was selected as both the team and the league most valuable player. Jerry Canavan finished the year with a .730 save percentage in goal. Paul Versams, Matt Carberry, Jerry Canavan, and Peter Bidstrup were all first-team MAC selections. Bidstrup set a new F&M career scoring record with 169 points. Despite the brilliant season, Franklin and Marshall was overlooked in the selection for the NCAA Division III playoffs. Of the 1986 team, Ross Sachs wrote to alumni, "We were MAC champions and proud of it. We were good enough to make the NCAA playoffs, but were overlooked, although we were extremely disappointed. What we accomplished made us think higher than this disappointment, to the fact that we were as good a team as any team to represent the blue and white, and that put us in good company." Anticipating a final year for Coach Sachs, the 1987 team was strong from start to finish. They finished eighth in the National Division III rankings and had convincing wins over Bucknell, Mount St. Mary's, Gettysburg, and Fairleigh Dickinson to win the Middle Atlantic Conference Championship. Dan Garrett was named to play in the North-South game on attack. In addition, he was named an All-American Honorable Mention. Matt Carberry was named Honorable Mention All-American at midfield. Jeb Barrows scored 59 points and made the All-MAC squad. Dan Garrett tied the record for the most goals in a game with 8. And he set a new F&M record for the most goals in a season with 48. With the retirement of Ross Sachs, an era had come to an end. In a Dear Gang letter, Coach Sachs announced his retirement. In communicating with alumni, he said, quote, "Your presence in my life during this time was consuming. I was part of the phenomena that takes place here where young lives come, green as anything, and graduate almost unrecognizable from that beginning. My work seemed to be relative to that transition," close quote. Following his 8th Middle Atlantic crown, Ross Sachs was selected as the North head coach in the North-South Classic and won his final game 17-16 after trailing by 6 goals in the fourth quarter. With the arrival of Coach G.W. Mix, the team was ready to go to the next level, the NCAA Division III playoffs. With striking determination, the team registered wins against Roanoke, Bucknell, Lehigh in overtime, Washington and Lee, and Gettysburg to win the MAC title. The team advanced further than any F&M team had ever before or since, by reaching the NCAA Division III Final Four with wins over Drew and Cortland State. Senior Ken Grammis ended a brilliant career by being named to the North-South squad at midfield while being recognized as a second-team All-American. John Dale was named as a second-team All-American on attack. John Rogers was selected as an honorable mention All-American on defense. Goalie Scott Cousins, who recorded a .690 save percentage, was named as an honorable mention All-American also. Cousins set a new F&M saves in a season record with 225. Jeb Barrows set an F&M career point record with 236. Ken Grammis was named as the team's most valuable player. The 1989 team came within 2 goals of winning the MAC crown after suffering a 7-5 loss to Gettysburg. They had highlight wins over Washington and Lee, Western Maryland, and FDU Madison. John Dale was a second-team All-American on attack, and John Rogers a third-team All-American on defense. In 1990, for the second time in 3 years, Coach Mix's team secured the Middle Atlantic Conference Championship and a bid to the NCAA Division III playoffs. They played a schedule that featured games against the University of North Carolina and close losses to Washington and Lee, the University of Maryland, and Washington College. They beat Drew University in the MAC playoffs to secure the championship 18-13. John Dale became the first diplomat to become a three-time All-American, as he was selected as a second-team All-American on attack. In addition, he made the North-South team and established a new F&M record for most points in a season with 92. Alex Henry and Brian Riley were honorable mention All-American selections at midfield and defense, respectively. The teams coached by Bill Dergel from 1991 to 1993 kept F&M competitive, posting records of 7-8, 9-4, and 4-9. During this time, Alex Hendrickson was twice named an All-American at midfield, while Tim Hampson was twice accorded All-American honors on defense. During these seasons, Mike Ryan, Alex Hendrickson, Tim Hampson, Rob Gioia, and Joe McGlone were named to the North-South squad. Entering his second season, Coach Frank Federaca coached a 1995 squad that was simply devastating on offense. With the combination of Don Gervais and Chris Murgart on attack, the Diplomats overwhelmed a succession of league and non-league opponents, posting a 12 wins, 3 losses record. They were given an at-large bid to the NCAA Division III tournament and lost a tough game to Gettysburg 15-9. In the final rankings, F&M finished 5th in the Division III poll. Coach Frank Federaca was selected as the National Division III Coach of the Year. Collectively, the team boasted 4 All-Americans: Andrew Giobi, Jason Roberts, Don Gervais, and Chris Murgart. Roberts and Giobi were named to the North-South squad on defense and midfield, respectively. The 1996 team registered a 9-win, 4-loss record, with close wins over Cortland State, Clarkson, Washington and Lee, and Western Maryland. A late season 13-12 overtime loss to Gettysburg eliminated the Diplomats from hopes of clinching the recently formed Centennial Conference title. Attackmen Chris Murgart and Don Gervais were named to play in the North-South game. Murgart was named second-team All-American, and Eon Sobler, honorable mention All-American at midfield. Jeremy Nierman was also selected for the North-South game. The season saw strong performances from Andrew Whitley in goal and John Bloom on defense. During his career, Chris Murgart established 4 separate scoring records which still stand to this day. 1997 through 2000 were transition years, with strong performances from Tom Coleman, who was a 3-time first-team Centennial Conference All-Star, and Brendan Beagles, who made the Centennial Conference All-Star team twice. In 2001, the team under Coach Dave Webster regained its winning ways behind the All-American performance in goal of David Kahn. The team was selected to play in the first Centennial Conference tournament, which is a feature of league pay to this day. 2002 saw the transition of a new coach and a new day with the arrival of Bill Goro, whose first team posted a 9-win, 7-loss record. Chris Shellhorn was outstanding on defense and was named Honorable Mention All-American, and also represented Franklin and Marshall in the North-South Classic. Mike Sartorius turned in a sterling performance as a freshman goalie, gathering 208 saves, and was named as a Centennial Conference All-Star. With standout wins against Denison, Washington and Lee, and Gettysburg, the 2003 team received outstanding performances from All-Americans Brian Nolan at attack and Jonathan Singer at midfield. Singer was also invited to play in the North-South game. In a stunning upset, the Diplomats defeated sixth-ranked Lynchburg 13-12 in overtime after scoring two goals during the last minute of regulation. It would mark the fourth time that Franklin and Marshall had participated in the NCAA Division III tournament. Strong performances in 2004 and again in 2005 kept the team in the hunt for the Centennial Conference crown each year. For their efforts, Boz Solovald and David Toller were named to play in the 2004 North-South game. The following season, Matt Capone, Steve Welsh, and Colin Hanley represented the Diplomats in the North-South Classic. In addition, Matt Capone was named All-American at midfield as he dominated the faceoff specialty with a stunning 78% success rate. Steve Welsh was named as the Centennial Conference Most Valuable Player. Mike Sartorius finished a brilliant career as only the second person to start in goal all four seasons. Today, at Franklin and Marshall, the building blocks are in place for another climb to excellence, an environment of academic excellence integrated with a winning lacrosse tradition makes for a future full of bright prospects and the leaders of tomorrow.